Now that the Canadian Migration Monitoring Network has been in existence for 20 years, we have a huge amount of data. And right from the beginning, researchers have used our sites and our data to produce their own research papers, over 150 to date. And the trend, population trends that Birds Canada calculates that are based on our standardized banding and count data, census data, are published on Nature Counts. But one thing that we haven't done much of and for the first 20 years is to put our trends together into national or range-wide trends. And these are the most useful for conservation and management purposes. So it sounds like it's a straightforward thing to put our trends together into national trends, but actually it's not. And that's really what this talk is about, is what other data do we need and how do we use it to allow us to do nationwide trends. And the species that we're going to use to explain this is the Blackpoll Warbler. Now, we chose this species because there's been a huge decline since 1970 when the Breeding Bird Survey began, according to the Breeding Bird Survey. But as you see from the map on the left, the breeding range of blackpolls is boreal forest, is quite far north, whereas the distribution of BBS roots from the map on the right is very southern, and there's not a whole lot of overlap. So the decline in the BBS is not highly certain. In contrast, migration monitoring stations are going to count birds from the entire breeding range because those birds have to pass through southern Canada on their way south and again on their way north. And the blue dots here indicate migration monitoring stations that have recorded no significant change in blackpoll populations over the past 10 years. And you see there's only one station in eastern Canada with showing a big decline. And it was this discrepancy between migration count trends and the BBS trends that made us choose blackpoll warbler as a sample species for comparing migration and BBS trends. Now, one of the difficulties with doing this is when you put the trends together from individual sites, you have to know which part of the range is being sampled from each site. And these two made up scenarios kind of illustrate what the issue is. So on the left, the size of the arrow in gray is supposed to represent the proportion of the population that's migrating along that route. So the great bulk of the western birds are flying towards the east coast, as they do in the fall, but they mostly bypass our stations in the southern part of the range. And if all of those birds were passing through that site where there was the decline in the east, then that station in the east represents a huge portion of the population, and the species may actually be declining severely. But if you look at the map on the right, if the migration is more sort of southeast, so that the western birds are being sampled by the western stations, and the portion of the range being sampled by that eastern site are mainly the ones coming out of Quebec and Labrador, then the decline might be quite localized to that region. So that explains why we need to know what the migration routes are of these birds and what's been captured at each station. The technique that we used to define migration routes was to look at stable hydrogen isotopes ratios in tail feathers. And just to briefly explain, there's a geographic pattern of the amount of deuterium in rainfall, and that's shown in the map at the right. So the pattern, or rather the isotope signature in the rainfall of the local region where a bird grows its feathers, is just built right into the feather. Then those feathers are retained from the time they're grown until the next year's molt. And that happens right after breeding. So if the bird grows its feathers as a juvenile on the breeding ground or as an adult on the breeding ground. And then if you catch the bird at any time in between the breeding seasons, then you can look at the hydrogen ratio in the feather and determine where it spent the previous summer. Now, to get the feather samples, you collect two feathers from each bird. This does not affect the flight capabilities, and they quickly grow back. And these can be stored for a long period, and analyses done even years later. They still have the signature. Now, the advantage of this method is that you can catch a lot of birds at one site, and in one season even, and get a lot of data points for where those birds spent the previous summer. You don't have to recapture the bird as you do with many other marking methods. The disadvantage is that the zones are not at all exact. You can see, for example, the orange zone in the map at the right, a bird with that isotope signature could come from northern Quebec, it could come from western Alaska, or from some areas in central North America. So that wouldn't be very helpful, but fortunately there are some other data sets that we can use to help us figure out where in these very broad areas where the bird actually came from. The data we used for this purpose was wing length. Now, wing length, it tends to be longer the farther the distance the bird has to fly. And migrants going to Alaska have routes that are almost twice as long as the routes to, say, New England or Nova Scotia. And the wing length does increase as you go west across the breeding range, and the Alaskan birds have wings that are almost an entire centimeter longer than the wing lengths of birds in Nova Scotia. I'm not going to talk much about the wing length data per se the rest of this talk, but I just thought I'd show you the amount of data that we had. Over 25,000 wing length measurements, largely from migration stations, but also from across the breeding area. And these data proved very useful in helping us separate birds from Alaska that have isotope signatures that are also found in the east. Well, the first step in putting the isotope data together was to divide the breeding range into isotopic zones. Now, the east is that area that's mainly blue from Ontario eastward. That's fairly distinctive, and if you have a bird with that signature, you're pretty sure it came from the east, aside from the issue of Alaska, which I have talked about and we'll talk about a bit more. The birds from west of the Great Lakes are not, or that area is not easily divided into distinct zones. So we divided that somewhat arbitrarily by that red line, which is basically a latitudinal division. Well, let's say you have one individual bird whose isotope signature is that light green that's indicated by the blue arrow in the legend. The areas where that bird could have come from are two blotches on the map that are surrounded by dashed blue lines next to the yellow area. So there's a very broad region from which that individual bird could have come. Now you take all the birds from one particular site and you overlay these maps of the individual individuals to see what the most likely region is for the bulk of birds coming from a particular location. So on the upper left map here, birds from Tommy Thompson Park, caught, captured in fall, most of them are coming from the north region. There's the bluer the area, the darker the color, the more birds came from, were likely to have come from that region. The upper right and lower left maps are more ambiguous because the blue areas are spread across the country. Fortunately, there weren't many distributions like this, and we found that wing length could help us separate birds that were likely to have come from Alaska versus ones from the east. And then the lower right is shows a map for the station that collects all of its birds from the eastern region. Now this map shows what was known about migration routes for a long time now. Basically, the birds in the fall leave the breeding range, go towards the northern part of the Atlantic coast, and then take off over ocean to reach their wintering grounds in South America. And in spring, they come up through the Caribbean, enter the U.S. through Florida and a little bit further west on the Gulf Coast, and then make their way across the U.S. into the breeding range. So our data fit this picture very well, but we also could provide more detail, especially in the spring. So this map shows what we think the fall routes are like. We put all our data together. In the fall, the birds do not use the southwestern part of the migration range, which is shown in yellow, and they don't come much farther south than the Great Lakes, as indicated by that dashed blue line through the U.S. Instead, the birds are going strongly east-southeast to the North Atlantic coast, and the birds from the west hit the coast a little further south than birds coming from the east, but they all mix together once they're east of the Great Lakes, and they then take off on over ocean flights. The spring migration is based on less detailed data, and you see on the upper left map, there's just an arrow in the U.S. that shows that once the birds are in the U.S., they go north. But you can imagine that they might fan out evenly, as shown by the black lines that I've drawn on the lower right map. And if that was the case, then you might expect the birds that are going to the eastern part of the breeding range, east of Ontario, those birds might be the ones that you would catch at migration stations in the northeastern U.S. and in Ontario. And birds going to the west might only be captured at western stations. In fact, we found it wasn't quite like that. It's true that the birds going farthest west are on the western part of the migration range, and most of the birds going to the east are going right up along the coast, the Atlantic coast. But in between, there isn't an even fanning out. And you can see that I've circled the area around the southern Great Lakes. And it turns out that the stations in within that area, which is most of the ones in southern Ontario and some in the central New York and Pennsylvania, and even as far east as McGill, they're catching birds that in spring that are not going to the eastern region, but are going to northern Manitoba and northeastern Northwest Territories. Now, not only is this new information, but it's also very helpful for migration monitoring because it means that there's some longitudinal separation of the birds that are heading to different segments of the breeding ground. And that by having CMMN monitoring stations across the country, we're actually sampling separate zones of the breeding range at each of those stations. These results for Blackpoll are being incorporated right now into a national calculation for range-wide trends of Blackpoll populations, and we hope that will be done soon. But the results are good enough already that Environment Canada is keen to do more work on other boreal nesting species. So the ones that are pictured here are all species for which CMMN already has a lot of feather samples, and more are being collected this year and next year to try to fill some gaps. So eventually, we hope that a goal of the CMMN, since its early days, is going to be fulfilled, that our data will be used for long-term trend monitoring and assessment of species at the national scale. There are hundreds, maybe even thousands, of people who have contributed to the data set that we used in this study, and we can't give enough thanks to the people who do this work. If you want to see the full publication of the work that was just summarized briefly here, it's available online at avian conservation and ecology.